Hello, everybody, and thank you for joining us today for the hip hop workshop from Sidewalk to Stage with the Dynamic Rockers. My name is Olivia Cipriano, and I'm the manager of programs and operations at the Hudson River Museum. Before we get started, I just want to go over a couple of technical details with everybody. If you're on Zoom, your mic will be muted upon entry. However, your camera will still be on. We do encourage you to have those cameras on for when we are going through the demonstration portions of this workshop today. We want full participation from anybody who is willing to share. However, during the lecture part, if you would like to turn those video cameras, you can definitely do that. To turn the video cameras off, what you do is look at your Zoom toolbar, which should be at the bottom or the top of your screen. And it should be nice and long. And on the left side, you'll see a little camera icon. You can click on that camera icon to turn your video on and off. Comments can be facilitated through the chat function in Zoom. Or you guys, if you're on Facebook, can go and type those comments into Facebook. I will be keeping an eye on the Facebook comments section. And you guys, I will relay all of those questions out to the Dynamic Rockers right when we get to that little section. So I am so excited for today's program, especially because we have the Dynamic Rockers here today for this brief hip hop lecture slash demonstration. The Dynamic Rockers were born and established in 1978 and are known as one of the founding crews in hip hop. They're known for being one of the first crews to battle on network television worldwide at the 1981 battle at the famous Lincoln Center against the not so good Rocksteady crew. Their most known works include VH1 Hip Hop Honor Awards, McDonald's Battle Royale, and given the label of cultural ambassadors by the US State Department for taking part in Dance in Motion, a cultural diffusion dance project between US, Paraguay, and Uruguay. The Dynamic Rockers' mission statement is to influence men, women, and children all around the world in the true culture of hip hop, which is peace, love, unity, and having fun. So please zoom in, relax, and enjoy.
Hey everybody, how's everyone doing? My name is Jason Mouse Vasquez. I am Vice President of Dynamic Rockers Crew. As we said before, Dynamic Rockers Crew. Audio, internet, bump. Can everybody see me?
We're getting a little feedback.
What did I do?
If you turn the sound off on the computer, you should be okay.
Let's do that. Hold on. Is that better? No, I got some feedback. Meeting settings.
Thank you for bearing with us for these technical difficulties. We're still, it's a new type of format still, so we're still working out all the glitches during every workshop.
I'm so sorry, guys. I had this worked out and then something happened. Is that better? Is that better? Is that better? Is that better? Is that better?
Try talking now.
And I'm talking now. No. Is it because the host didn't mute me?
I've unmuted you now. No, that didn't work. And you have sound off on the computer for the output.
How do I do that?
You can go to your computer settings and turn the volume down. There's usually a little volume button for speakers.
Hey Mouse, just to jump in, can you hear me? There's two screens that say Tweet Boogie. If you have two devices on right now that are next to each other, having two devices on the same video chat will create that feedback.
Yeah, I think he's trying to do audio through one and visual through another. So I think the sound just needs to be off for both devices so that you're only picking up audio and not sending it out or not hearing it yourself.
I'm calling my technical person to come back up. Hey, can you come back up to it started feedbacking again? All right, guys, bear with me one second.
Thank you guys all for your patience. We'll be getting this program up and running shortly. All right, while we're waiting, Viri and I have a few programs coming up this week. Later tonight at 7 p.m., we have a planetarium show, virtual planetarium show, which is pretty cool. We have Mark, and we also have two of our planetarium educators. We're going to have Tony and Ron helping out with that, and it should be really fun. And later this weekend on Sunday, we have a program called Curators Tour from Home. So during these Curators Tours from Home, we usually have our curatorial department head, Laura Vukels, working with some of her staff or talking with some of her staff about different things that we have on exhibition in the museum. And today we're going to be talking about the tiles in Glenview, our historic home, which is really fun. So this Sunday at 1:30 p.m., it would be really cool to tune in. But on Wednesday, we also have a planetarium show for kids on Tuesdays, which is great for kids. And Mark usually runs those. This week it was the moon. And next week we have a different program. So you guys keep your eyes posted for that. Viri, do you want to talk about what's happening on Wednesday?
Sure. On Wednesday, we have a program that is story time, and we are exploring a story wrote by Faye Ringle. I have the book right here. So after the story time, we are going to have a project that is for kids, and it's basically just doing a landscape with a city, skyscrapers, with a nice scene. So I invite everybody to join us. And if you have a kid at home, just and read with us this book. Also, we will have like some junior docents facilitating this program. Junior docents are like part of the Hudson River Museum. Right now, we're working in partnership with the Junkers Workforce Department. And they are working right now in the summer. So, and some of them, they are here. I am really happy they are in this season with us.
Yes, it's always very exciting to have our junior docents helping out and participating in everything. I think they really bring a nice, fresh element to everything. And they are also very smart and very talented in all of their own ways, too. And Vitor, you're doing such a good job bringing them together with the museum.
And they were in this workshop. They were really excited to learn something about hip hop. So I think that Tweet Boogie is ready.
Yeah. All right. Whenever you are ready, Mouse, you can take the floor. I think if you are still trying to figure it out, we can just hang in there for another couple of minutes. All right, we are also opening up the museum this weekend. So for the museum, we are doing timed ticketed registration. So when you buy your tickets at the museum, you're gonna be buying them for a time slot. You're registering for a time slot. And you can only go into the museum during that time period if you have the tickets for that slot. However, we have the Derek Adams exhibit open and ready to go. So if you guys are interested in coming to the museum this weekend, you can find our webpage, www.hrm.org, and you can register to come see some of our exhibits at the museum. Mouse, are you ready?
I am ready. Can everyone hear me?
I can definitely hear you, yes.
Definitely, great. I am ready, good. And okay. Everyone can see me as well?
Let's find you on here. I think you have your camera turned on or off, let's see. Where, there you are. All right. And I'll spotlight you so we can see you. All right. Cool.
Hi, everybody. All right. Okay. Later. Okay. Hi, everybody. Sorry about that. Technical difficulties. And we are back. Again, we are Dynamic Rockers. Dynamic Rockers has been around since 1978. I'm not that old. Here to give you a brief lecture demonstration on breaking. So before we even get into that, let's get into what is hip hop. So what is hip hop? What does everybody believe hip hop is? So keep in mind, this is an interactive show. So at some point I will be getting at everybody and want you to jump in with me. Not at the moment, but we'll get into that. So let's get to it. What is hip hop? I like to do an analogy of a table with four legs, right? So every leg holds up a part of what hip hop is. So we're gonna start off with our first leg, the cornerstone of hip hop, which is DJing, the DJ. No DJ, no hip hop, no dancing, no party, no hip hop, nothing. It doesn't happen. So the DJ is the cornerstone of hip hop. That is what hip hop is. That's how it started with a big guy by the name of DJ Kool Herc, the very first DJ to put hip hop all together. So DJ Kool Herc is the man who put it all together. August 11th, 1973, started hip hop on that day. That is the birth date of hip hop. 1520 Cedric Avenue in the Bronx, New York is the birthplace of hip hop, where Kool Herc threw his first party and labeled it hip hop. So the DJ is the cornerstone of hip hop. We move on to graffiti. Graffiti is actually even older than hip hop. You know, you can go back to the Egyptian times and be like, you know, or see all the hieroglyphs, and that's graffiti. During World War II, there would be pieces of bricks written up, Kilroy was here, and that was a part of graffiti, you know. And now moving on to the 80s as to what that graffiti meant to us within hip hop was, you wanted to get your name in as many places in the five boroughs where it can be seen on a train, on a wall, anywhere that it can be seen and be seen through the five boroughs. You just wanted to get your name up. Graffiti artists did not want to be known. They did not want to be famous. They wanted to be infamous. So you would see like dot on the wall and dot on a car and dot on a train and dot on someone's ceiling. And you'd be, and it'd all be different ways of writing dot. And they'd be like, yo, dot is dope, man. But no one knew who dot was. And that was what graffiti was. That's what graffiti artists wanted to do back then. Two parts. So we got DJing, we got graffiti. Moving on to the third part. The MC, master of ceremonial, which you guys know as the rapper now, which is now the marketing part of hip hop. They're the really big part of hip hop. But back in the days, they didn't even know what a rapper was. You know, if you was back in the late 70s and the early 80s, you'd be like, yo, I rap. People would look at you and be like, what you mean? You rap a gift? Like, they did not know what rap meant until later on when they started building and corporate America got into it and they started making the MC the rapper. Now they're the headstone of hip hop. And last but not least, the breaker or the dancer. Hip hop now has many styles of different dances, but today we're getting into the number one dance of it, which is breaking. And that is what me and my partner Elite, who is also a dynamic rocker, who that's what we do, that's what we specialize in. So jumping right into it, anybody know why a breaker is named the breaker? Can anybody just take a guess when you turn on the camera, turn your speaker on and just shoot a guess? Why is a breaker named a breaker?
I think I'd be cheating if I answered.
Anyone? Going once, going twice, three times? Here we go. A breaker is named a breaker because we dance to the break of the record. And the break of the record is where all the words drop out and it's just that funky beat. James Brown, clapping hands, stomping feet. Clap your hands, stomp your feet, clap it. Eli, hit me with the top rock. And if everybody just starts watching Eli, he gonna get down for a little bit, get down. My man is getting down with some top rock, getting down with the top rock, getting down with the top rock. He's doing it up, he's doing it up, he's doing it up. I can't see Eli right now. Where he at? There you go, hey, don't shake the booty, don't shake the booty. Wrong show. And that's how everybody was getting down. Now, when breaking first started, there were no crazy dynamic movements. There was no spinning on your head. There was no flying from here to Venus. That didn't exist. There was regular dancing on top. Everybody was dancing exactly the way Eli was just dancing, right? Until two guys came along and revolutionized breaking. They were the very first B-boys to go on the ground and stay on the ground. They were twin brothers. They used to dance for Kool Herc, and they go by the name of the Legendary Twins. And they would do just like this if Eli would help me out. They would stand on opposite sides of a room like this. And then they would walk up to each other, back to back, and do like this. And then they would start dancing around just like everybody else. And they did this one move called a Zulu turn. Hit it, Eli. Oh, don't make me dizzy. They did that one move and that revolutionized breaking. Next thing you know, everybody was going down to the ground. Then came Spy, the man with 1,000 moves. And Spy would look at the twins and they'd be like, yo, I'm better than that. Y'all whack. And he would dance and he started by doing what we now call a six step. And the six step looks like this. Hit it, Eli. Boom. Boom. Yeah, give it up for Elia. Now it's a six step. Can anybody guess why it's called six steps? Because it's six steps. So after that came Zulu Kings, came Beaver from Zulu Kings, and he added onto the vocabulary by doing this kick sporadic style kind of movement and what we now call freezes. And we have three very special freezes that we're gonna show you right now. And Eli, hit the baby freeze. Boom. And then from there, chair freeze. Boom. Great. And now do whatever freeze you want, Eli. Hit him with a whole bunch. Oh. 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 Hey. Give it up for Eli. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Leap. And then after that, moon started getting bigger and bigger and better. Then came trap two. One of the very first Hispanic breakers. Now, Track was a gymnast in high school. That's what he used to do. He used to do gymnastics. So one day they was like, yo, get down Track on the concrete. And he did a flare. Anybody know what a flare is? Anybody want to turn their mics on and try to tell me what a flare is? Anybody? Going once? Going twice? Three times? No? All right. So I'm going to show you what a flare is. Well, I'm not going to show you. Eli's going to show you what a flare is. This is what a flare looks like, y'all. Hey, give it up, Eli, one more time, y'all. That's what I'm talking about. Flares, baby. And he upped the ante of breaking. Then came the very first crew to turn company, which was the Rocksteady Crew. And the Rocksteady Crew was just like any other crew, getting down on a piece of cardboard or on the concrete until a guy by the name of Michael Holman came along, who was somewhat of a manager to Rocksteady. Say, hey, I could get you into the movie Flashdance. I mean, you guys seen Flashdance? I'm pretty sure none of the kids have ever seen Flashdance. If you haven't seen Flashdance, Google, YouTube, Flashdance. Say, hey, I can get you to the movie Flashdance. They were like, nah, yo, people gonna fight our moves. Niggas on see us on TV, they're gonna steal all our moves. No, we're not down with that. No. And Mike was like, but I can get you about 6,000 each. And they were like, okay. So they do the movie Flashdance, right? And when they do the movie, they become worldwide. Next thing you know, everyone in the world knows Rocksteady Crew. Next thing you know, Rocksteady Crew starts traveling the world. They start going to Russia, Berlin, England. They start traveling Spain, Africa. They come back to America, and breaking is just bigger than ever, right? They had huge billboards on Times Square in New York City with B-boys like this. They had huge, huge commercials of breakers and stuff like that. They had leading with B-boy action figures when you pull the string and the B-boys return right next to the G.I. Joes. I mean, you guys remember G.I. Joes? I kind of figured that you wouldn't remember G.I. Joes for all my young ones out there. Yep. So after that, other crews started becoming companies. So after that came Dynamic Rockers Crew, New York City Breakers, you travel to the West Coast, you got LA Breakers and Air Force Crew, and all these crews turning into companies, which gives us our jobs that we have today. So I'm actually going to be quiet for a second, and Eli is going to be the man to get down for you. I'm going to throw on some beats. Eli is going to get down for you and show you what breaking really looks like. Here we go, y'all. Give it up. That's what I'm talking about. My man Eli putting in work. One second, y'all. Let me take the thing. Boom. There we go. Yeah. All right, and that's what breaking fully looks like, y'all. And this is what we do for a living. We don't do anything else. We follow the rules of hip hop. Hip means to know. It's a form of intelligent. Hip means to stay update and relevant. Hop is a form of movement. You don't just look at a hop. You got to hop up and do it. Hip and hop is intelligent movement or relative movement. We just be selling the music. Is everybody with me? Yep. Okay. So now we want to step into real quick Q&A section. Does anybody have any questions for us? Anything on hip hop? Anything? Anybody want to unmute their mics and ask any questions for me and Eli? What is it that we do? How do we do it? Et cetera, et cetera.
How do you train when you start learning to dance hip hop?
Nice. Eli, you want to take that one real quick? And I'll take a second.
All right, so that's a great question. She asked, how would you start training when you would get into this dance called breaking, especially being involved in hip hop? You would start from the bottom, just like any other dance. You would start conditioning, just like me. Sorry, I'm a little out of breath. we would start the very first footwork set we usually teach, the sixth set. I think every breaking teacher, instructor, can agree that six step is the foundation that for all power moves, for all footwork moves, all freezes, because it's a universal transition as far as being the footwork move. So I would start learning one of each breaking pillar, top rock, footwork, freezes, and power moves, if you want to start from the bottom.
All right, I'm going to piggyback off of that really quick. So so learning breaking, when I started learning breaking, it was a very different time. So me and Eli are very different ages. when I started learning breaking, hip hop was not popular in dance schools. So there was no such thing as a hip hop class in a dance school at that time. So you can nowadays, you can go to any recital school, you can go to any university, you can go to any institute and take hip hop. And my time, which is long time ago, hip hop in school did not exist. So if you wanted to learn how to dance, you had to learn on the street with everybody else. And what we did as kids, because we didn't have a mirror like you would in most dance studios, you have a mirror and you can see someone else's, you can see the teacher's reflection, you can follow steps and stuff like that. We waited for nighttime to come around and we waited for the lampposts to come on from the street. And when the lampposts would come on in the street, you would be able to see your shadow. And we used our shadows as a mirror. And that's how we first started learning how to dance hip hop, by having some type of reflection to look at. And we didn't count. We didn't count on the street either. We were kids and we didn't even know how to count, really. Like, you go to any dance school now, they'll teach you how to count 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You know how to count music, but we weren't doing that. We just were rhythmically in tune with the music. So, you know, in those times, if it was me and Eli, I would look at Eli, I'd be like, yo, Eli, you want a beat? You want, you know what I'm saying? Okay, oh yeah, all right, bet. And we was on the same beat. And we learned like that. And it was a real hard trial by error learning on how to dance hip hop, because there was only one way to do it. And that was just by doing it. And you would crash and you would get what we used to call B-boy scars and burns on our shoulders. We're doing windmills on the floor, on concrete. We danced on concrete. We didn't have no wooden floors. Cardboard didn't come till later, you know? So it was a big trial and error every time. But we kept pushing and we kept doing it until we formed this vocabulary now that we have, which is the four pillars for breaking, which is top rock, footwork, freezes, and power moves. And you would learn those four first. And then you would get into everything else. You get into blow ups and super big power moves and, you know, air freezes and stuff like that. But those were the four pillars that we learned from. And not exactly in that order either. You would jump on whatever you could. So I hope that answered your question as much as possible. Any other questions?
We have a couple questions from the chat, actually. Hillary wanted to know what inspired you to start dancing.
Say that again, I'm sorry.
What inspired you to start dancing?
Okay, so for me, keep in mind, me and Eli come from two very different generations. So in my generation, I started earlier than Eli. I won't say how old I am, but I started much earlier than Eli. And in my generation in dance, at that time, hip hop was a part of the community, because this generation sees hip hop on TV, right? You got YouTube, you got Instagram, you know, you got all Facebook, you have all these portals now that you can use via internet. I grew up on dial-up, where it was like, and it took forever to come up. I came up AOL times when computers were real, real slow. So we didn't really rely on the internet or computers. It was still being done in the neighborhood. So with that being said, if I walked out of my building, they'd be like, they'd be like what? They'd be like a couple of guys in front of the building, and they would start rapping, and you know, they start freestyling, they're rapping in front of the building, and they're going on and on and on. And then when I walked out, and then I walked into, like, if my mother was to send me to the store for milk, and I walked out the building, there's guys rapping in front of the building. I walked down the street, there would be a graffiti artist. And a graffiti artist used to carry around these things called black books. They were these little books, and they were black. And if for my youngins out there, or even my older people, you remember your yearbook from high school? And then, you know, you would try to get as many signatures in your yearbook from high school, and the person who had the most signature was the most popular kid. Very similar to that, all the graffiti artists, all the writers, they wanted to get their blackboard filled with everybody's names in the neighborhood, so that they would know they had the most juice in the neighborhood. They had the most political power because everybody knew them, and they could prove that because you could go back in the book and it'd be like, yeah, you know, John 1 wrote in my book. That's how I know John 1. You know, he know me. So that was a big thing for graffiti artists back then. So, you know, walk down the street, graffiti artists come up to me, be like, yo, Mouse, you want to put your tag in my book? I'm like, yeah, no doubt. And I put my tag in the book. Then I walk into the store, get milk for my mom, and there'd be the DJ. And the DJ, remember, now you have iTunes, you got Spotify, you got Tidal, you got all these things where you could download, stream music. Back then, we didn't have that. All we had was the mixtape. So in order to get the music from that rapper, or get the music from what happened at that party, you had to be at that party. You had to know that rapper, you know, and the only way, and if you didn't know him, then you had to go to the DJ who's playing their music. So I would be inside the bodega, I'd go into the store, and for all of you out there in the hood, it's called bodega. So I would walk into the bodega and they'd be like, yo, Mouse, you went to the last party? I was like, yeah, I went to the last party. It was like, it's slamming, right? I was like, yeah, that party was dope. They'd be like, all right, so buy my mixtapes. Here, 2 for $5. And I bought 2 mixtapes off of the DJ right then and there, because that's how they was making their money. And then I'd get the milk from the store, and then I'd head back out, and there'd be a whole bunch of guys. And they'd have cardboard in their hands. They'd have a radio. They'd have a linoleum in their hands. And they'd be like, yo, Mouse, we about to go downtown Times Square, 42nd Street, and we're going to go dance for money. And on the street, that's called hitting. So it's called hitting. And they'd be like, yo, we're going to go hit. You coming through? And that means they would dance for money. And so I'd be like, yeah, let me just drop the milk off to my mom. And I would drop the milk off, then I would join them, and then we would dance in Times Square for money. And that was called hitting. It's still called hitting up to this day. And now they do it on the trains too. But now breaking has been replaced with light feet, which is a new dance of hip hop that's out right now. And that's what they're doing on the trains now. And that's what's popular. But, you know, all things evolve, all things change, which is really cool and great. I love to see that. And so that's just to explain how I lived inside of hip hop. Most of everybody now watches hip hop, but I lived inside of it. And that was my experience. And that's what I lived. I was very poor. Well, no, there's poor and then there's po. I was po. So I grew up very, very down low. And my only exit out was hip hop. And that's, I jumped on that train and I kept that train running, and that was my story. And so that's what inspired me in hip hop. Elite, your turn.
So yeah, like Mal said, we come from very different generations. Myself, you know, being a 90s baby, I did grow up to hip hop. I grew up to different hip hop. you know, I grew up to a lot of Wu-Tang. I was exposed to a lot of Tribe Called Quest even. So me growing up, being exposed to that, you know, especially being able to study the things like native tongues, you know, movements, a lot of different movements are what inspired me to definitely get into this dance, along with being from Pennsylvania and seeing kids around me, you know, spinning on their head and like doing some crazy stuff at the park. And I'm just like, whoa, that's kind of cool. I definitely want to learn that. So I was inspired by the youth around me. And then growing up, watching crews like the Dynamic Rockers, which, you know, it's a blessing to be a part of now, such a legendary movement, a legendary crew. That's what's kept me going as far as dance as well. But the original inspiration for me was the youth, you know, and now being able to give back to the youth, me being a lot older than when I started, is keeping me inspired every day. So we have some other questions in the chat. If you want, I can go ahead and piggyback and answer the next if you like. The second question was, what makes you take dance seriously as a job? That's another great question, just because of the opportunities that are present right now in this generation. And there are a lot more opportunities present as far as dance than maybe say 10 or 20 years ago. Why I take it seriously as a job, number one, I teach children. I teach all ages, but I definitely focus on children. So that means teaching the next generation, also teaching them what's between right and wrong, and especially using hip hop as a movement in order to guide, you know, a lot of children, a lot of youth in their lives. So that's what makes me take my instruction seriously. What makes me take shows and traveling, I've been to over 13 countries. Hip hop is taking me to 13 countries, Turkey, Ukraine, Russia, Denmark, Germany, Iceland, taking me a lot of countries. That keeps me motivated and keeps me taking this job as seriously as possible. It gives me the opportunity to travel, to hone my skills and to really travel. So yeah, I'm very blessed to be able to do what I love and get paid for it. Not as much as you think, but I'm still getting paid for it. So I'll leave it to Mouse to answer the rest of that question.
That's dope. So yeah, jumping on it, it's changed for me. It really has. So when I first got into the game, I got in with the idea of just getting out. I had to get out the hood. And I was in a really, really bad predicament, really, really bad place. Grew up in a bad neighborhood in Brooklyn, you know, dealt with everything that you can think of when it comes to a neighborhood stricken by poverty, right? And so I saw the opportunity, and it wasn't a big opportunity. It was just guys dancing on the street on Times Square. But when I saw some guy walk by and put $100 in the bucket, that opened my peripherals and said, I could do this and make a living off of it. And there's money here. And if it means that I gotta be out on the street 12 hours, I'd rather be doing this than doing something illegal. And so that just kept motivating me and kept pushing me. And then I took it not only with hip hop, because I've been to school for dance. I graduated Hofstra University, dance education's degree. And I went all the way, ballet, modern, African, Afro-Caribbean, tap, jazz. But my go-to was always hip hop, because that's what I started with. And so being a young kid from the hood and making it out, and then once I got out, because that's all I was trying to do, I just wanted to get out. And then I was just riding the wave. And the wave wasn't always, so you know, water is never like this. It's never still, right? Especially in the ocean. You're gonna deal with waves, currents, rivers, and everything's gonna move like this. And I just, I was with it. And I was like, whatever trial or tribulation came with it, and suffering, if it meant sleeping on the street, being in the shelter, and you know, and then, you know, just dancing on the street, making money to keep my stuff in a locker. You know, I was always fresh though. You would never know that I was homeless. I was always fresh. And so I'd be fresh on that audition line, 4,000 people trying to get into an agency, trying to get onto the next Broadway production, trying to book the next commercial, you know, trying to jump on the next concert that took me around the world. And it was a lot of bumps and scrapes and bruises and a lot of no's. You're too short. You're too tall. You ain't got no hair. You don't have enough hair. You know, it was, you're too white. you're not black enough. It was just a whole bunch of things that it was always no. And it wasn't until I bumped into the Rennie Harris Pure Movement Company that Rennie finally gave me my shot. And he was like, I like the way you dance. And I was like, I like the way your company do. And he was like, here's a plane ticket. And he took me to Brussels. And that was the first time I ever left the country. And I left with him, left to Brussels, stood with the Rennie Harris Pure Movement Company, traveled with them for a while, came back. When I came back, my name started ringing a little bit of bells. And Tyler Perry got a hold of me. And Tyler Perry was like, hey, I'm doing a show called You Don't Know Me. I think you fit perfect for the character. And I traveled with Tyler Perry doing all his off-Broadway shows for 6 months. Lived in LA for 4 months. And then we went to Houston. And then we went to Atlanta. Did that for a while. Then I started jumping on other stuff. Started doing concerts. Jumped on. There was a time where hip-hop kind of died out. And it was all pop music. So you had, you know, Justin Timberlake and Christina Aguilera and Blink-182 and the Backstreet Boys. And if you wanted a job dancing, you had to do that. And I was like, nah, I'm not doing that. I ain't dancing behind no Britney Spears. I wasn't with it. You know, I wasn't trying to, I wasn't with it. So I was like, nah. So I got with a management company, Divine Rhythms Productions. Elka Samuel Smith became my manager. And I was like, yo, just book me for every rapper and see what happens. And she's like, you crazy. Rappers don't book breakers. I was like, just do it and see what we get. So I went to Puff Daddy and Bad Boys. They turned me down. I went to T.I. Grand Hustle. They turned me down in Atlanta. Then when I finally got to Aftermath with Dr. Dre in Los Angeles, he said, maybe. And then it took me 4 years of just trying to link up with him and trying to work. And he was like, you know what? I got a new artist coming out. His name is Yellow Wolf. And I'll let you get on with him. And I got on with Yellow Wolf and I was just doing promo tours at small little bars and clubs. And, you know, the hip hop community started hearing about breakers at rapper shows and they started coming in. And then a small crowd of 150 turned to 300. Then 300 turned to 800. 800 turned to 1600. And then, Dr. Dre saw the buildup and he was like, yo, you know what? I'm gonna put you on the Aftermath tour. And I got put on, it was me, Dr. Dre, 50 Cent, and Eminem. And we got put on, and Snoop Dogg, and a couple other people too. And we got put on to the Aftermath tour. And me and a couple other breakers, this was before Dynamic. We got on that and we started rolling with that. And you know, I started traveling the world with them. And then I got booked by the US State Senate and we got to travel the world again. We went to London, Mexico, Ireland, Russia, Belarus, Ukraine, and then came back. And it's been on ever since. So my reasons for starting changed. I rode the wave and then I got in and then I was at a part that I was really, really blessed. And then I broke my hip and I was paralyzed for a year and a half. And I was in a wheelchair and I had to learn how to crawl. I had to learn how to walk. I had to learn how to run again. I had to get a regular job. I worked at a place called East Cash Express. It was a check cashing store. And it was the most craziest experience I ever had. I've never had a regular job before until, you know, I kept pushing it. Dynamic helped me out. Thank you, Kid Glide. Thank you, Papa Glide. And they helped me out. And I finally got back on my feet. I started dancing again. The physical therapist called me up at my job and was like, yo, Mouse, you could walk again. And you could start dancing again. I was like, oh, word. I was at work. I looked at my manager and I was like, yo, I quit. And I walked right out the door and I jumped back on the lines and started auditioning again. By this time I was with Dynamic, so they helped me out a lot. And we were back on the map and we've been pushing ever since. And now I push even more because now I got 3 kids and I got a car and I got a house. So I got to hold up all these bills. And the only way I know how to do it is dance. I'm not turning back. That was a lot. Sorry. Any other questions out there?
I think I saw a couple more in the chat.
I believe there's one more in the chat. So we have Diamond asking, what's the craziest place dance has taken you? Oh my goodness. I can let Miles answer that one. I got to think of
the craziest. So the craziest place dance has ever taken me. This is not a good story. Not like, you know, a highlight. I was in like some other country. This is a bad story. I was 16 years old, dancing on the street. I knew nothing about a contract. I knew nothing about what per diem was. I knew nothing about what an elastic clause was in a contract. Knew nothing about what 1099, W4, W2. I had no idea what any of these things meant. And I'm pretty sure a lot of everybody who's out there is like, what does that mean? I don't know what that means. So you in the same boat I was back then. And we was dancing on the street and this guy walks up to us and says, yo, I have the second biggest black circus in the world. We want you guys to come dance for us for 900 a week. And we was like, 900 a week? And I didn't call my mama. I didn't call my daddy. I didn't say nothing. I went to a Model's down the block, picked up some clothes real quick, and I jumped into the stranger's car and we rode down to West Virginia and we were gonna be part of the second biggest black circus in the world, right? It was good for the first 2 days and we was in Newport News, Virginia. And we was in a hotel, they put us up in a hotel. We was like, oh snap, we in a hotel? Oh snap, yo. And then it was lit for the first 2 days. And then we actually got to go see the circus. And we was like, I swear to you not. It looked like these small teepees that you buy at like Home Depot. And it was just like, and they had like, I lie to you not, like cats and dogs was there. And they had no elephants. They had no lions. None of that. They had a cat and a dog and maybe a mule. And I was like, what in the world is going on here? The second day, we go back to the hotels, we wake up in the morning, and then the concierge at the front desk looks at us and says, who's paying for the hotel? And we were like, excuse me? And they were like, yeah, your managers and everybody you came with, that bus you came with, they left. And we were like, what? And they left us in Newport News, Virginia with the bill. I called my mom and was like, mom, I'm sorry. I didn't tell you nothing. I know I've been gone for weeks. I'm in Newport News, Virginia, and I was trying to dance to make some money, and I didn't make nothing. And my mama was like, are you stranded? And I was like, yes. And she was like, good, stay there. Click, and hung up on me and left me out there. We had to walk from Newport News, Virginia, and walk to Virginia Beach to go dance on the street over there to make money to get bus tickets to go back to New York. When I got off the Greyhound in New York, my mother was waiting for me with a belt in her hand. And all you see was me running down Times Square. My mother like, I'll go kill you. I'll go kill you. I'll go kill you. That was the greatest experience and the craziest place dance has ever taken me. Eli, shoot.
All right. Mine isn't as crazy as Miles's. I had a supportive mother. actually, believe it or not, I'm in Mexico right now. I live in New York City, but right now I'm in Cuernavaca, Mexico, which is close to Mexico City. So I'm still traveling. I've been here since April. I just have a lot more space here to dance and to teach online. But as far as a crazy, crazy place would have probably been Turkey, because Turkey, being out of all the countries that I've been to, Turkey was the most, I think it was the most different in culture to American culture, because of just the culture shock when I got there, it was like, whoa, like you're American, what are you doing here? You know, as a B-boy, as someone from Philly, I'm just like walking around the streets of Turkey, you know, and I have people threatening me for being American. So that was the biggest culture shock and the biggest adventure that dance has taken me. I had to, I started lying, I'm gonna be honest with you. I started telling everyone I was Puerto Rican. I'm full Puerto Rican, but I wouldn't tell anyone I'm American in Turkey because I was scared of saying I was American. You know, they had a really big grudge against Americans there, especially Syrians there. And so it was a weird experience. A lot of stories go into that experience, but that would be my answer for that question. Turkey, yeah.
Do we have any more questions?
There are no more questions in the chat or on Facebook right now, but if you guys want to move on, you definitely can.
So let's move on to the participation section. you guys get to see Eli dance. Now we want to see you guys dance. So do I have any brave volunteers who are willing to turn the cameras on, turn their mics on, and let me and Eli give you a very brief, short, easy breaking class for you guys to learn from? Very simple, easy breaking moves. This is stuff you could take and go rock out at the club, impress your friends, or just rock out at the barbecue. Who wants to turn the camera on and get busy with it? I see a camera on there.
Awesome.
I got one. Who else I got in here? Let me see.
Gina is ready.
Do any of our junior docents want to turn their cameras on?
Yeah, I want the kids, man. Where the kids at? Let me see kids, man. You got at least do one or two steps with us. Look at y'all, scared. It's cool. You can join us.
I got
cool.
you guys.
There we go. You can join us if you like with the cameras off. That's fine, too. I understand if it's something that, you know, you're not used to. All right? All right, cool. Can everybody see me? Yes?
Yeah.
All right, cool. We're going to start off with a very, very simple step, all right? So, everybody's with me. Everybody feel good? All right. So we're going to start with a very simple step, and we're gonna step front, and we're going to do it to the front. So we're going to step to the front on both sides. This step used to be called the Indian step, but we don't call it that no more. So we switched it up, and so we're going to just do these side steps. So everybody just step on my left, your right, my left, your right, my left, your right. 5, 6, 7, and step. 5, 6, 7, and step. 5, 6, 7, and step. Cool. So you're going to go 1, and then you're going to step out 2. There you go. Big hands, right? And then you see those hands real big. Come back. 5, 6, 7, and 1, 2, right? And you got to be like, what? Because, you know, you're stepping up to that person. You're like, what? So 5, 6, 7, we go 1, 2, and then we do the other side. 3, 4. Very good. Now, let's try this all together. 5, 6. 5, 6, 7, and 1, 2, 3, 4. Gucci. We're gonna try that a couple of times, right? So we're gonna do it 8 times. Here we go. 5, 6, 7, and 1, 2, 3, 4. 5, 6, 7. One more time. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Hold. Hey, there we go. I got you. I saw somebody almost fall over there. All right. All right, so here we go. One more game. So 5, 6, 7, 8, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now hold up. This dance comes from the street. It's raw, it's real. So you can't be doing this dance like. Okay, no. You gotta get into it. You gotta be in the ground with it. Here we go. 5, 6, 7, last time. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. One more time. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, hold. Now from here, we're gonna do what's called a Brooklyn Rock. You see little booty at 5? Very good. Ladies, don't do this, okay? 5, and you're gonna come down 6, and then you're gonna spin up, hit him with the breaking pose. Hey, all right. Now, we're gonna try to attempt to do this. We're gonna attempt, keyword, attempt, keyword, attempt to put this all together, right? All right. Here we go. 5, 6, 7, 8, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. One more time. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Brooklyn Rock. And 1, down 2, spin up, and breaking pose. Hey, that's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. Now, it's not over. Now we gotta do it with the music. Dun dun dun. I'm gonna play the beat, I'm gonna drop it, and then we're gonna get it in. Here we go. Switch.
Something gonna make you move.
Nice and slow.
Talking about. Thank you for everybody who participated in that part. I hope you had a lot of fun doing it. Breaking is fun. It'll get you up off your feet. All right, before we go, does anybody have any last questions? Anything? What is this? Anyone else? We're open to answer one last question before we leave. Going once, going twice.
Well,
three times.
I guess my question for you is, what are we looking forward towards next from Dynamic Rockers?
Hey, that's what I'm talking about. All right, so a portion that we didn't even get to talk about. So for those who don't know, breaking is going into the Olympics, 2024. Breaking will be at the Olympics. They will make their debut in Paris. We did the Youth Olympics already, and so now we're moving on to the Olympics. And it will now be a full bona fide sport in the Olympics. So a lot of people are training and getting ready for that. Dynamic is training, not particularly us, the older generation, but our new generation coming along, getting them ready for the Olympics. And we also have KBL Studios. We have our first dance studios. It was a long trial in the making. And we have a dance studio, 735 St. Nicholas Avenue, Harlem. We have our studio in Harlem where we train kids for shows, productions. We do a lot with the youth. We not only do breaking there, we do a lot of things there. We do graffiti there along with other things, primarily for the kids and hopefully in the future, getting them ready for the Olympics. KBL, Kids Breaking League. So we have this concept where we take kids and we take them to other people's schools and they battle each other. So there are other breaking schools or schools that have breaking teachers, and we take our kids to go battle those kids, and those kids come to our studio and they battle, and we have a league that we start for the kids so that they can be doing something as well. Elite, you want to add on some more?
Yeah, like Mal said, we have a lot of things going on, especially with the youth. The Olympics it's a crazy goal that we're looking towards too. Like you said, I work for KBL Studios in Harlem, wonderful place. Teach kids not only to break, but really to believe in themselves and use dance as a tool to advance better in life. As far as individually, we have tons of things going on. You know, we have people in Netflix shows, Netflix movies. We have, I think one of the Dynamic Rockers was with us. I don't know if she still is. Her name was Erica.
Oh, Erica was there. Cool.
Yeah, she does the bodybuilding. You know, all the Dynamic Rockers have their own things going on, which not only involve breaking, but also involve other aspects of life, which we're excelling as far, you know. But we use that dynamic name because we do, what's the word I'm looking for? I'm at a loss for words. Sorry, I apologize. But we do keep that dynamic name and we keep our core values, you know, especially within hip hop, of peace, unity, having fun, peace, unity, love, and having fun throughout life. So everything that we do as a Dynamic Rocker, we apply those values. So that's all I have to add. Thank you, everyone, again.
Yeah, not only that, it's just, I want to piggyback off of that. Individually, we do have a lot going on. Individually, we have everything that we do as Dynamic Rockers, and then we have what we do individually. one of our crew members. He's a full-blown actor. You can see him in a whole bunch of stuff. He was in Daredevil. He was he did a whole bunch of the NYPD Blue, CSI. He did a whole bunch of those. And full-blown actor, he does that. Dreidel, B-Boy Dreidel, dope guy, does his thing. And then Dynamic Rockers is not only New York City. We have various chapters all around the U.S. So there's the New York chapter, there's the Maryland chapter, there's the Carolinas chapter, Utah chapter, and building the Philadelphia chapter. So there's a lot of us all around, and we all do a lot of work. Me, myself, I'm with quarantine and everything happening, we're having to switch everything and going viral. So we're doing a whole bunch of shows viral. We're doing a whole bunch of our classes on the computer and on the internet and whatnot. So our future with this crazy quarantine going on is all via going internet. We do want to put out a whole bunch of small skit movies that we want to start putting out. I don't want to start naming off the projects until they're fully done, but that's something that we have in mind too. We have a battle going on this Saturday. We have a call out battle that we're doing this Saturday. We have the show that we're doing with Henry Hudson Museum. So we've got a lot of things going on, man. Come check us out.
We all are very excited to see. Also, where do we get some of those shirts?
We got them coming.
All right, we'll keep an eye out. I want to say a big thank you to you guys for coming here and doing this program with us. This was a fun, it's not the typical kind of museum program that people usually have, but you know, it's fun to bring elements of different communities into our community. And arts are so much more than just what you see on paper and what you read in writing. So we love bringing other kinds of visual arts to the museum as well. So thank you.
Thank you for having us. And we look forward to working with you guys all the time. Kids, yeah. I'm sorry for the technical difficulties earlier today. I'm old. I'm new to this stuff, but I'm getting there. I'm there with you. I'm getting there.
All right. And I want to thank everybody for coming here on Zoom and anyone who's watching on Facebook. Thank you for watching. Like I was mentioning earlier, we have a lot of programs coming up. The museum is opening this weekend. We also have amphitheater season. And if you guys want to see Dynamic Rockers perform live, we have you can look towards our HRM website, www.hrm.org. And you guys can find those events coming up under the calendar. So you just need to pull down the menu tab and hit calendar and upcoming events, and you'll see them right there. You guys can also look at our Facebook page. Our Facebook page will have all of the upcoming events on it as well. And that's www.facebook.com/HudsonRiv, R-I-V, Museum. And you can find that those events there. Thank you again, everybody, for coming. We had such a great time with you guys. And we look forward to seeing you later next month.
Hey, thank you guys. We really appreciate it. Have a good one. Bye.